Hi there everybody, my name is Jeremy Krug and I'd like to welcome you to another chemistry video. In this video, we're learning about the applications of electron configurations, at least a few of them. Now, in the last several videos, we've spent the bulk of our time practicing how to write electron configurations. Now, as it turns out, there's a name for the specific type of electron configurations that we've been writing, and these are called ground state electron configurations. Now, ground state basically just refers to the most stable electron configuration for an element. This is basically where atoms are spending most of their time. This is almost like the electron's home. They spend most of their time in this ground state. Now, when we say on a quiz or a test or a homework assignment, write the ground state electron configuration for an element, all that means is you're being asked to write the regular electron configuration that we've learned how to do in these last several videos. That's all that means when we say ground state. Now, if there's a ground state, then there must be some other kind of state, right? And as it turns out, there is. The other state is called the excited state. And this happens, or this exists, whenever we add energy to electrons. So for example, let's say we have this atom here. This is an oversimplified picture here of an atom, but we have the nucleus, we have an electron hanging out here in the second energy level. And if we decide to add energy to an electron, and we might do that by sticking the atom into a Bunsen burner flame or jolting it with some electricity, well, what's going to happen is that energy is going to cause the electron to jump to an outer energy level, kind of like this. And so that's the excited state. Now, we know that when an electron is in its excited state, of course, it has more energy. It's more energetic. But this is also a temporary state. Now, this jump is something that we call a quantum leap. Whenever an electron jumps to an outer energy level, or when it jumps back home, back to its ground state, those are called quantum leaps. Now, the excited state is kind of like an electron being on vacation. It's excited, just like you're excited whenever you're on vacation. Now, we also know that that excited state, that vacation state, is temporary. It doesn't last forever. You can't stay on vacation forever. Eventually, you have to go back home. And it's the same way with this excited state electron. Eventually, it has to go back home to the ground state. Now, notice what happens when it goes back. Well, guess what? It has to emit that energy that it absorbed the first time around. So it emits that energy as light. And so a lot of the light that you see is actually a result of this specific process here, where electrons are being jolted with energy in some way, and they jump out to some excited state, but then when they jump back to the ground state, they're giving off light. And by the way, every element gives off light in very specific wavelengths, or very specific colors. And so, for example, if you take sodium, just as an example, and stick sodium ions into a Bunsen burner flame, you'll find that the sodium burns with this orangish yellow color. That's almost like a fingerprint that tells us that we're looking at sodium. Or if we're looking at perhaps strontium ions, you put that into a Bunsen burner flame, it burns with a very bright, beautiful red color. Every element has its own color fingerprint. And we can actually use this to identify elements using something called a flame test that I hope you have a chance to do in your laboratory. Now, here's another item that we have here. Let's take a look at just a random element that I chose off the periodic table, aluminum. And we can see where aluminum is on the table right here. And let's look at its electron configuration. We know that aluminum has the electron configuration 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p1. That's the electron configuration for aluminum, or aluminium, as you can also say it as well. Now, this electron configuration serves as kind of a map to tell us where the electrons are located in that atom. So for example, this coefficient of 1 out in front here is referring to all the electrons in the first energy level, or the first electron shell of that atom. So the 2 right there as the superscript tells us that the first energy level has 2 electrons in it. That's what that means. And likewise, for the second energy level, we look at these values that have a coefficient of 2 out in front. And since those superscripts are 2 and 6, well, 2 plus 6 is 8, so that tells us that the second energy level has 8 electrons in it. And we can do the same thing for the third energy level. We look at the ones that have the 3 as the coefficient out in front. And then their superscripts, the 2 and the 1 here, you know, 2 plus 1 is 3, so that tells us that the third energy level has 3 electrons in it. So that's like a map of where the electrons are. Now, as it turns out, some electrons in an atom are actually more useful and actually do more things than other electrons. As it turns out, the electrons in the outermost energy level of an atom, or that outermost electron shell, are actually more important than the atoms or than the electrons in the inner shells of the atom. In fact, we give those electrons a name. The electrons in the outermost occupied energy level of an atom are called the valence electrons. Now, that is a phrase that refers to the electrons located in the outermost occupied energy level, or the outermost electron shell of an atom. And in this course, as we talk about chemistry, not just in this chapter, but also in upcoming chapters, we're going to talk about valence electrons quite a bit. So you'll want to pay close attention to valence electrons. These are very important because they're the outermost electrons. And the reason that they're important is that in a chemical reaction or a chemical bond, it's the valence electrons that are actually doing something. Those are the electrons that are shared or transferred or are jumping around if there is a chemical reaction or a chemical bond taking place. Now, we can say that aluminum has 3 valence electrons, can't we? Now, let's try this for another element. Let's try boron. So we can see where boron is on the periodic table, right here, and we can write its electron configuration as 1s2, 2s2, 2p1. A much shorter electron configuration than some that we've been working with. Now, how do we count up the valence electrons? Well, we look at the highest coefficient that represents the outermost electron shell, which is the second shell in this case, and then we add the superscripts together. So 2 plus 1 add up to 3, don't they? So this atom, boron, has 3 valence electrons. Now, let's try a different atom. Let's try gallium. So we can see where gallium is on the periodic table right here. So its electron configuration is going to be 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 4s2, 3d10, and 4p1. So a little longer than boron's was. But how do we calculate the number of valence electrons? Well, we find the highest coefficient in the configuration, which is the 4 here, and then we add those superscripts together. So 2 plus 1 is equal to 3. And so that means gallium has 3 valence electrons. Now, we've just done 3 different elements, and we found that all 3 of them have 3 valence electrons. Now, where are they located on the periodic table? Well, let's see. All 3 of these that we've calculated, boron, aluminum, and gallium, are all in the same group of the periodic table. They're in group 13, as in like 1, 3. And they all have 3 valence electrons. So is that a coincidence? Well, I don't think so. In fact, let's try another group on the periodic table. Let's try, maybe on the farther right side here, let's try fluorine. So we can see where fluorine is on the table, and its electron configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p5. And its quantity of valence electrons, we look at the second electron shell there, and then 2 plus 5 is equal to 7. So guess what? Fluorine has 7 valence electrons. Now let's try the element right underneath fluorine on the table, which is chlorine. So here's chlorine. And its electron configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, and 3p5. And to calculate or to count up its valence electrons, we just add these superscripts that are found in the third electron shell. So 2 plus 5 equals 7. And so that tells us that chlorine also has 7 valence electrons. And notice, they're in the same group. They're in group 17. And they seem to have 7 valence electrons. There's a pattern there, isn't there? Now, if we wanted to, we could do this same process for the whole periodic table. And we'd find the patterns. Now, we don't have enough time here to do the whole table and determine that. I'll just go ahead and show you what the pattern in the valence electrons is going to be. So for group 1, all these that are the alkali metals, those are going to have 1 valence electron in them. All these atoms in the alkaline earth metal series, group 2, they're going to have 2 valence electrons. We already said that the elements in group 13, the boron group here, will have 3 valence electrons. The elements in group 14, the carbon group, will have 4 valence electrons. You kind of see the pattern, don't you? In group 15, guess what? It's going to have 5 valence electrons. The atoms in group 16 are going to have 6. The atoms in group 17 are going to have 7 valence electrons. And almost all of the noble gases here in group 18 are going to have 8, except for helium. Helium's electron configuration is 1s2, so it only has 2 valence electrons. But all the other noble gases have 8 valence electrons. And so hopefully you can look at the periodic table for any of the representative elements and tell just by looking at where it is on the table how many valence electrons it has. So for example, silicon is right here on the table. It's in group 14, so it has 4 valence electrons. Or magnesium is right here on the table. It's in group 2, so it has 2 valence electrons. Or we could look at sulfur. It's right here. It's in group 16. It has 6 valence electrons. You can predict this for any of those representative elements. I hope you learned something from this video. I hope you found it helpful. If you did, please slam that thumbs up button and consider subscribing if you haven't done so already. Thank you for watching. I'm Jeremy Krug. This is the place for honors chemistry and AP chemistry. I hope to see you again in the next video.